So welcome everyone to tonight's teleconference. I'm Chef AJ and I'm so excited about our very special guest, Dr. Alan Goldhammer. I couldn't sleep all night because I was so excited to have such a big star in the plant-based world on the call tonight. Before I introduce Dr. Goldhammer, I just want to say that we're doing these calls every week now. If you're not on my mailing list, it's www.eatonprocess.com. The reason I suggest you may want to be on the mailing list is because then we email you who's going to be the guest so that if you have questions, you can email them back. So that would be one reason to do it. We will be doing this every Thursday night from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. Pacific time, which is 9 p.m. Eastern time. There will not be a call in 2 weeks because I'll be lecturing at Rancho La Puerta in Mexico. So to make up for it, we'll be doing 2 calls next week. Next Thursday, I will have the Esselstyns on, Ann Esselstyn and Jane Esselstyn, talking about their new book, The Prevent and Reverse Heart Disease Cookbook, and I'll also be interviewed on Tuesday for a bonus call by Wendy Solganic, the blogger of Healthy Girls Kitchen, and the call will be about sugar addiction. So next week is all the wonderful ladies of Cleveland. Dr. Alan Goldhammer is the founder of True North Health in Santa Rosa. He's been responsible for helping over 30,000 people reclaim their health. He is the co-author of one of the best books of all time. If you haven't read it, you can buy it on Amazon or my website or the True North website. It's called The Pleasure Trap. It really is a must read. And Dr. Goldhammer is the reason I've been able to become a skinny bitch. I met him in January of 2011 as a patient in True North, and I've had the privilege of being asked back there for a period of about 12 weeks over the last 4 years to be a guest chef and lecturer. And I'll be there again in December, on December 21st through January 2nd at the True North Holiday Cooking Extravaganza. That'd be a great place to spend the holidays. You don't have to fast. We're going to be focusing on healthy SOS-free cooking, and you can get to meet Dr. Goldhammer in person. So I will introduce him the way I always introduce him when we get the privilege of speaking together like we did in Texas. True North is where I'd rather be. SOS-free is the life for me. Every meal, all we eat is green. Where the hell I get my dopamine? Bum, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba. Goldhammer is the doc to see. If you want to live addiction-free, he will tell you not to eat that crap. Before you know it, you're out of the pleasure trap. Bum, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba. No food, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba. Bad mood, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba. The fast, ba, dum, ba, dum, ba. Won't last, food was my life. Goodbye to the strife. True North, we are there. Ba-dum-ba-dum-bum-bum-bum. Welcome, Dr. Goldhammer.
Well, it's going to be a little hard to top that, isn't it?
That's okay. Listen, you are so popular. We have never had this many questions for a call. So would you like to get right into the questions, or would you perhaps want to just maybe say a few words about yourself and True North in case there's somebody on the call that has never heard of you?
No, I think we should go ahead and get to questions and go right through it.
Okay, great. All right, well, thank you so much. So there's a lot. Okay, the first one is from Kay in Rhode Island. She says that many of the recipes in the Bravo cookbook contain fruit juice, and that she heard that Dr. Esselstyn said that fruit juices are unfavorable, that it's just as bad as eating sugar, and they injure the endothelium, and so she wondered why those were allowed.
Yes, well, I would agree. Fruit juice, like any concentrated sweetener, needs to be modulated, particularly for those people that have primary health concerns or dealing with weight issues. However, it is a question of proportionality. Fruit and the juice of fruit in the quantities that are used in the Bravo cookbook provide recipes that, you know, give you the variety and enhancement people are looking for without the caloric density that prevents them from making progress. And we certainly see that clinically. We can use, you know, that moderate degree of sweetening agent in appropriate recipes without compromising our ability to make clinical progress. Now, if you look at those, first of all, if you look at most of the recipes, they do not use sweeteners like mm-hmm. fruit juice.
Sure.
Those are pretty well restricted to, in very small quantities, certain dressings might have a little apple juice or raspberries or something of that nature, and also some of the, quote, dessert items. So, you know, the question is, you draw your lines at a point where your grams of sugar per serving are appropriate, and I think we've done that both in the Health Promoting Cookbook and in the Bravo Cookbook. One of the purposes of cookbooks is to give people a broad range of recipes that will not only meet their own needs, but the needs of the people they're having to interact with. Because let's face it, when you get into this program far enough, you don't really need a whole lot of cookbooks or recipe books or anything else because you're eating whole food. You're eating fruit, you're eating salad, you're eating steamed vegetables, you're eating minimally processed grains, legumes, perhaps a few nuts or seeds if you're able to tolerate that. And so recipes become much less of an issue as you get farther into it. However, during that transition from eating a conventional SAD diet into eating a vegan SOS-free diet, not everybody can make that transition overnight. And so we're trying to provide tools that allow people to make it in a progressive way using standards that are consistent with people getting well. And I think, again, I'm quite satisfied with the degree that we've done that. Yeah.
Right. And I love what you just said, and I wrote it down, that the purpose of recipe books are to meet the needs of the people you interact with. That is so true, because you're so right. I've been following the True North diet now for so many years that, like you, I just eat pretty simply, and I don't even want to be making or creating recipes. I just want to eat the food, but you're so right. It's for the other people. That's brilliant. Thank you. Now, you had mentioned SOS free, and just in case there's somebody on the call that hasn't read The Pleasure Trap, do you want to describe what SOS free
is? Yeah, SOS is, of course, traditionally thought of as the international symbol of sign of danger, SOS, save our ship, etc. But it also stands for sugars, oils, and added salts,
right.
SOS. And so by getting rid of the highly processed chemicals that we add to food that lead people to be fat and sick, we can dramatically improve a person's ability to achieve a higher quality and quantity of life and health.
Right.
So the premise is that the reason people get fat is because they overeat. And they overeat because they stimulate the brains in their brains with chemicals that are added to the food. For example, if you take rats and you let them eat as much as they want, if they're a rat chow, they get to a certain size. But if you add the chemicals, which are in fact sugar, oil, and salt, to the chow of those animals, they'll overeat and they'll get fat. If you do it with birds, the same thing happens. Birds will eat so much they can't even fly.
Wow.
And if you take normal human chow, in terms of fruits, vegetables, grains, and legumes, they get to a certain size, eating ad libitum. But if you put sugar, oil, and salt in their food, they will progressively overeat and become overweight, and then develop the diseases of dietary excess, like cardiovascular disease and diabetes. They'll develop obesity. They'll develop autoimmune diseases. And if we get rid of the sugar, oil, and salt and go back to eating ad libitum of a health-promoting diet, they lose their weight, and they can largely recover their health. And so we believe it's actually these chemicals that are added to food, that is sugars, oils, and salts, that are responsible for why people's brains are being fooled through the excess production of dopamine, and they get caught in what we call the pleasure trap.
Wow,
That is the big issue that we see in industrialized society. It's interesting to note today there are more people getting sick and suffering from obesity in the world than there are starving from malnutrition.
Oh my.
You actually have a higher percentage of people now dying from overnutrition than undernutrition. It doesn't mean there aren't some people around the world starving. It's just that now overweight is actually the dominant nutritional cause of health.
You know, I read somewhere that we spend something like 800,000 times more on weight loss products in this country than we do like for world famine relief worldwide, that we're spending all
wow.
this money. But that's so brilliant what you just said. But how did you know this? Did you figure this out? Did you coin the term SOS free? Because you've been doing this, I think, longer than anybody, or at least longer than anybody I know. You've been doing this for 40 years. How does a 15-year-old kid in 1974, you know, think to adopt a sugar, oil, salt-free diet? I mean, there was not even internet back then.
No. Well, I was, it was, a, you know, like for most people, necessity dictates the actions people take. Most people that decide to try to get healthy do so by force, not by choice. It's usually pain, debility, or fear of death that motivates people to seek a change. In my case, it wasn't pain, debility, or fear of death. It was desperation because my best friend, Doug Lyle, could beat me in basketball, and it really frustrated me. And so I decided to figure out some way to beat him. And I started reading books, and I thought, well, maybe if I got healthier, I could perform better, and then I'd be able to beat him. And I came across the natural hygiene books, and I started reading. It made a lot of sense, and I thought, well, I'll adopt this kind of a diet. Unfortunately, it completely failed because he adopted the same diet, and to this day, he can still kick my butt.
Oh, boy. So the books, were you referring to, like, the work of Herbert Shelton?
Yeah, Human Philosophy, It's Life and Laws by Herbert Chelton was one of the
Wow,
books that I read.
that's
Made a lot
amazing.
of sense. And so at age 16, I dedicated myself to doing this type of a diet. I decided I was going to do it as an experiment. And I decided at that time I'd do it for 50 years.
Wow.
And I wanted to see, what would happen. And so, I've got another 9 or 10 years of the experiment to go, but so far it does seem to be working.
So in 10 years, we're going out for a cheeseburger. Is that the plan?
No, we just reevaluate the plan and then decide whether or not we're going to do another extension.
Did you personally coin the term SOS free?
I don't believe so. I think that that term was already floating around before I started to use it. I think that we certainly started doing a sugar oil salt-free diet early on, but I don't recall exactly where the first application of SOS came in.
Well, thanks. Okay, so Jimmy in the Bay Area, who actually came to True North last Christmas when I was there, writes, "I heard you disapprove of carob because it's a gateway drug to the use of chocolate. I have read that both cocoa powder and carob powder contain compounds that reduce artery clogging plaque and lower cancer risk. I understand that chocolate should not be part of our daily diet, but an occasional treat would seem okay. Please help me understand the exclusion of all things carob and chocolate."
Well, if you're counting on chocolate to be your anti-cancer plan, I think you're going to be sorrowfully disappointed. The fact is, all plant foods have both healing components, that is, primary micro and macronutrients, as well as phytochemicals. And many of them may have health compromising products, such as chocolate that has caffeine, a highly addictive nervous system drug, and other 2,000 other chemicals. But so the point is, there's good things and there's bad things in all plant-based foods. And a good example is wine, red wine, where they're trying to promote alcohol as some kind of health food. And they'll say, oh, if you don't drink now, you ought to start, if you're worried about your heart. And the fact is that alcohol, like aspirin, does have a blood thinning effect, such that if you're on a greasy, slimy, fatty, dead, decaying flesh diet at high risk for a clotting stroke, and you take an aspirin or you take some alcohol, it would have a thinning effect and might slightly reduce your risk of a clotting stroke. What they don't tell you is it may concomitantly increase your risk of a bleeding stroke, and that there's no evidence that all-cause mortality is reduced from taking alcohol or eating chocolate or any of these other, foods that are being hyped as some kind of, healthy food. And in the case of wine, there's a little resveratrol and some other antioxidants that haven't been completely destroyed in the production of this fermented food byproduct. And so they try to take claim to the fame that at least there's something there, and that's the justification for paying large amounts of money for some fermented product. It's complete nonsense, though. If you look at it from a health viewpoint, alcohol, for example, increases blood pressure, which is one of the major contributing causes of death and disability. It has 7 calories per gram. It acts essentially like liquid fat. That's why men get such attractive big beer bellies when they drink enough alcohol, and in fact, develop the famous plumber's crack. And in fact, now they're having to make jeans, I understand, that ride up a little in 2 inches higher, because
Oh.
apparently, I guess women were just going crazy over those plumber cracks, because I guess chicks dig that, and so they have to keep people under control by making the jeans go up higher.
Wow.
The bottom line is alcohol is not a health food, and neither is chocolate. Chocolate with 2,500 calories a pound, you might as well just, melt it down and rub it right on your belly and hips. That's where it's going to end up when you eat it. At least then you could wash it off and not carry it around all week.
Right. Oh,
So
my
again,
goodness.
I don't think that because there's a few residual nutrients that are still present in some highly processed food byproduct that we can claim it as health food. Instead, what we should do is go back to eating a health-promoting vegan SOS-free diet and avoid these highly fractionated food byproducts. The reason we don't, though, is we really like them.
Sure.
And we become very, very defensive. And we go to inordinate efforts to find some excuse to justify our addictive behavior patterns.
Right.
And so it's hard for people to give up chocolate because they like chocolate. They like the way it makes them feel. They like the artificial stimulation of dopamine in their brain. They like the effect of the caffeine. They've been conditioned too that, you've worked hard, you deserve a break, and a break is something that'll jolt the dopamine stimulation in your head.
But carob is a fruit, so what's wrong with that?
Well, carob would be less harmful than say, for example, chocolate. However, carob, like chocolate, isn't served on its own. I mean, if you wanted to go chew on raw carob pods, I certainly wouldn't be giving you any big objection.
I
The
see.
problem is, in order to make carob taste the way people want it to taste, you
Gotta
usually
roast
are adding
it.
oil,
Yeah,
salt,
roast
and
it.
sugar. It's highly processed.
Sure.
And so, chewing on carob pods, it's like saying if you want to go out and chew on sugarcane, that'd be my guest. I don't have any problem with that. Sugarcane is sweet. If you want to chew on some of it, it's fine. But do you understand how much sugarcane it takes to end up with that pile of sugar in front of
I
you?
was told by Dr. Hans Diehl that it takes 3 feet of sugarcane to make a mere teaspoon of sugar.
God, is that right? Oh,
That's
that's
what Dr.
fabulous.
Diehl told me.
3 feet of that. Okay, that's good to know. So
And
you're full of good
he said it
facts.
takes 16 ears of corn to make a tablespoon of corn oil.
Yeah. So let's not confuse ourselves when we look at processed food products, considering them still whole foods. What we do know is that, if you want to eat corn and you're not sensitive to corn, then eat the corn. But let's not take large quantities of corn, extract one component, in this case the corn oil, and pretend that that's going to somehow be
It's
healthy.
funny. I want to go back to Jimmy's question in a minute, but you had just mentioned corn, and we had a question from Sharon on how you felt about air popped popcorn, Sharon from Maryland, as a snack or a treat, air
So,
popped
air
popcorn.
pop popcorn is a highly processed food product that is relatively innocuous in the sense that, if you're not sensitive to corn and you don't put salt and oil and God knows what else on the corn, you could probably get away with eating that without any significant deleterious effect if you kept the quantity small enough. However, it is kind of a processed source of calories. So if your goal is weight loss, I don't know that it would be something I'd be going out of my way to try to include. However, if it was the alternative to, less or more destructive things, perhaps it might
Sure.
provide some useful tool. Having said that, though, there's probably healthier things you could be snacking on, in particular raw vegetable materials, things like celery, cucumbers, jicama, cherry tomatoes. We're always trying to get patients to eat more vegetables of all kinds, and particularly raw salad vegetables. So using raw vegetables as kind of a snack and a fill-in-the-gap food may actually have better utilitarian benefit than eating some high-temperature processed corn kernels. But sometimes you're looking for things to, again, help people around you, the kids, the
Sure.
entertainment, eating, that type of thing. And that would probably be one of the less deleterious ways to go. And I certainly wouldn't have a
Yeah.
primary objection to having some air pop
Right.
popcorn.
Yeah. So, but for weight loss, it would not be favorable, though.
No, I think you'd be better off doing the vegetable thing.
Sure.
Vegetables, with their 100 to 200 calories a pound, pretty much you could be eating from 6 a.m. to midnight, and you're still not going to get
Yeah.
overloaded. The
Okay.
high fiber content, the high nutrient content, the high mineral content, all of those would be favorable, plus the high water content.
Yeah, exactly.
So
Just
I think if we had a choice, we'd pick vegetables. But popcorn certainly would be at the higher list of the processed food products as far as something you could incorporate in the diet. And I guess we could say the same thing about these, like the rice cakes and these kind of things.
Sure. Well, this whole thing, because I happen to know both Sharon and Jimmy, and what I'm getting from their questions are like I guess they're asking your opinion, like how do you feel about things as an occasional treat? Because some of the other leaders in the movement say that I'm too strict, and if I'm too strict, you're way too strict, that we can't tell people that they can never have another cup of coffee or another glass of wine or another rich treat, that's actually more
Or
fun.
another cigarette or another line of cocaine or anything else, right? Here's the thing, AG, I have a bias. I'm working with people that are sick typically, and they're so desperate they're willing to do anything, even learn to eat good and exercise and go to bed on time. And when you get people that were addicts that become free, they don't need to keep teasing themselves. You don't tell alcoholics, well, just have a little bit of wine and beer. Just put your alcohol in a smaller cup and stir it around with a spoon and drink your alcohol through a spoon and put your spoon down between each sip and you won't be a drunk anymore.
Right.
You tell drunks, okay, you're an alcoholic, stop drinking. That's the answer. Now, are there some people that can drink a little bit and not be a drunk? Sure.
Yeah.
But if you're an alcoholic, it's not you.
Yeah,
You're
exactly.
not the person that can do that. Are there some people that can occasionally have a piece of chocolate or a little bit of this or that and not get fat and sick? Sure. There are people that can do that. But if you're overweight, guess what?
It's not
It ain't
you.
you.
Yeah, got it.
Because if you could have controlled it, you would have controlled it. And you can't, and you didn't, and you won't.
No.
So then wake up and stop playing let's pretend.
Yeah.
And let's pretend is when you think, oh, I can just have a little bit. Well, I don't think so for most of the people that I see. Because the fact is, if they were able to be successful with that modulation, they probably would have done it long ago.
You're doing great with these questions, but I'm really going to have to ask you to please don't hold back and tell us how you really feel, okay?
Sure.
I think you're terrific. Okay, a question from Teresa. To smoothie or not to smoothie? That is my question.
Here's a great question. And, you know, this is a common popular thing, the use of juices and smoothies in general. The reason people like juices and smoothies is because you tear up the cells and you expose yourself to more sugar quicker, okay? If you take the stuff in the smoothie, your kale and your fruit, and you take those alone, at first you may not like them because they're not sweet enough because you're, you know, addicted to that high sugar content. So when we blend all the stuff up and we expose our taste buds to all the sugar quickly, it's more appealing. Plus, it's easier because you don't have to chew and you don't have to spend as much time. You just blend it up and drink it, okay? So there's advantages to smoothies and juices in that they're easier to get people to take them at first when they're not used to enjoying whole foods. Eventually, we're hoping to get people to where they would just as soon have the whole food, and then they don't have any temptation to overdo it. However, people that are used to eating highly processed sugary foods and then they go to eating whole smoothies and things like that tend to do really, really well because, you know, it's so much less dense. It's just like our use of a little fruit juice in some of our recipes.
Sure, sure.
Yes, it is concentrated processed sugar, but it's much, much, much less intense, less grams per volume than traditional. So people get benefit from it, and you know, it's a step in the right direction. Same thing with smoothies and juices. If weight loss was our goal, the best strategy, if you're able to comply with it, is to eat whole food,
right,
whole salad, whole fruit. But occasionally having a smoothie may be a perfectly useful thing. For example, let's say somebody has time restrictions, and they just don't have time to sit down and eat that meal. Well, they should change their life so they have more time. But in the meantime, having a smoothie, you know, might have utilitarian benefit. They only get 30 minutes for lunch at work. It's hard to go through and eat a big, you know, 2 pounds of salad or whatever, so they'll have their green smoothie. Again, I don't object as long as doing that is working for you. However, let's say you're a diabetic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, having fruit juices, including the fruit juices, by the way, and some of the recipes in our book, might be too much for you. And so we have to exclude those. And sometimes we have to take fruit out of the diet altogether.
Wow. Well,
so people get healthy enough that they can process it.
Oh, wow. That, you know, it's funny because that is, I can't find it right now, but that was one of the questions, is that do you ever limit fruit in general or for diabetics? And if not,
yes,
we
do.
Eat all the fruit we want.
We do, especially, you know, until people have had a chance to reduce their insulin resistance with fasting and get, you know, put some distance between themselves and their diabetes and get their weight at optimum levels. We sometimes have to either limit fruit to one or two pieces a day of whole food only, or sometimes actually they're so sick that we have to eliminate fruit because their triglycerides and their blood sugar levels go up too much when they use it. And we almost always exclude all juices and usually, unless they're vegetable juices, and same thing with smoothies, we don't do too much blended processed food, especially with diabetics. We want to have whole food as much as possible.
But
let your mouth be the juicer.
Yeah. Dr. Esselstyn always says we weren't born exiting our mother's womb clutching a Vitamix. So I get that. For those of us that aren't trying to lose weight, can fruit be unlimited? And how does limiting fruit actually help with weight loss? Because I always got confused because fruit is of a lower caloric density than, say, rice, beans, or potatoes. But those always seem to be unlimited.
Yes.
Yet fruit seems to be the thing that occasionally does get limited.
Well, I don't typically have to restrict, let's be clear. First of all, you can overdo anything. Too much water, what do you call that? Drowning, right?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So, but generally, people can eat large quantities of raw fruit and raw salad whole and still achieve optimum weight loss. And the way we know is, let's say we're giving a person unrestricted fruit and vegetables and steamed vegetables and portion-controlled amounts of things like nuts, seeds, avocado, and concentrated foods. And they're losing, if you're a woman, 2 pounds a week, or a man, 3 pounds a week, then we don't do anything. If we're losing less than that, and the goal is weight loss, we're making sure, number one, they're sleeping enough, because if people don't sleep enough, their metabolism slows down, and they're fatigued, and they won't exercise, and they won't be successful. We make sure they're getting moderate exercise, so, you know, walking, hiking, biking, swimming, hopefully something they can enjoy, or at least not hate. And eating, you know, unrestricted quantities of large whole fruit, vegetables, steamed vegetables. If they're losing a little less weight, then what do? We double down and make sure that we're not doing any processed foods, and then we might start restricting some of the more concentrated caloric dense foods or possibly fruit. But fruit's pretty far down in the list of things I tend to restrict.
Got it.
Because usually we just don't have to. They lose 2 pounds a week every week eating those foods down to their optimal weight. And men, it's going to be closer to 3. Now, is that because men are 50% more disciplined than women? Or that men are much better than women? Or no, it's because men have testosterone. And testosterone is a fat-burning hormone. And so if you inject your women with testosterone, they lose their fat. Of course, they get hairy and get cancer and die, so it's really not a good weight loss strategy. But men, if you inject men with estrogen, they would get fat. They would get breasts and hips. And so these are biological, not psychological phenomena.
Mm-hmm.
Men have an easier time. That's why if you have a man and a woman go on a diet together, they don't lose weight at the same rate. At the same rate. In fact, you know, oftentimes women are frustrated because the man they know is sneaking out and having an In-N-Out burger at lunch and getting into all kinds of stuff, and they're losing weight, and the woman who's measuring and weighing and being all careful, it's very slow. And so, you know, women have to sometimes work harder and get less results, and that's just how it is.
Doesn't seem quite fair. Well, this
so the man might be able to eat, you know, 5 pieces of fruit and lose the weight, but the woman may only be able to eat 3. So, you know,
yeah.
You just have to. But you've got a good feedback here. We know what average weight loss expectations are. So if our target is 1 to 2 pounds a week and we're not meeting our target, then we can look back and fine-tune the thing. But frankly, most people, if they just fill themselves up with enough fruits and vegetables, are going to lose the weight, get healthy, and not have to worry about weighing, measuring, and
right.
anything else. They just have to eat enough good food so there's no room for anything else.
Right. Well, that's fantastic, and I found that to be true for me. This question from Barbara actually was asked by many people. We got this question more than any. It has to do with salt. There apparently was a McDougall Advanced Study last weekend, and they had some guy speaking and saying that if you go too low on salt, it's actually dangerous. So
okay. Well, let's be clear. There is the study, the PURE study, which came out and it got huge headlines, in part because anytime you tell people what they want to hear, you know, that tends to be popular in the press. And, of course, there's also a lot of vested interests here that are very, very concerned because there's a huge body of scientific literature that says we should reduce our salt intake because it's killing us. And even the American Heart Association, not exactly the bastion of healthful living advice, has finally come around and acknowledged that the vast majority of the literature that's available suggests that humans should be eating 1,500 milligrams of sodium or less a day.
Mm.
And these are some major studies that have, you know, supported this model. It's certainly consistent with our clinical experience. However, there is a study by PURE that used very questionable scientific methodology. They used a single morning spot urine to determine the sodium levels of the subjects. And they showed that there were some people that had low levels of sodium that also had problems. But they didn't properly correct for the fact that the reason why a very small percentage of the population was eating a very low sodium diet was often because they have serious health problems that motivated them to make changes. And it wasn't the low sodium intake that was necessarily causing the problem, but it was a result of the problem. And there are other variables too. When you look at the scientific methodologies on these studies, you find that they've been heavily criticized, the couple isolated studies that are heavily quoted in the popular press, because they tell you what the food industry wants you to hear, which is, okay, maybe we can't have high amounts of salt. Everybody pretty much agrees on that. But maybe you can have more than what the American Heart Association is, because if you go by the American Heart Association diets, you can't eat highly processed foods.
Mm-hmm.
And so you've got whole industries out there that are going to be in serious trouble if people actually pay attention to them. The entire fast food industry, most of the processed package industry, they just can't make it on that. Because
mm-hmm.
in order to make good foods taste good without adding salt, sugar, and oil to it, you have to start with good foods. And that's expensive. It's much better to take highly processed crap and just salt it up, sugar it up, and oil it up, and then people will think, because their brain is fooled by the artificial stimulation of those chemicals, that they're eating something that, quote, tastes good.
Mm.
And once they get addicted to high levels of sodium, they need more and more sodium in order to be satisfied. So, you know, you have a big industry. Like, who is pushing the dead Dr. Atkins diet? The fast food industry. Because they were the ones that were able to stand to make the most off of it.
Right.
And the same thing's happening here. You got some vested interests that are out there trying to blunt the truth, which is people do better on lower sodium intakes.
Mm. Right.
And they skew the data. You know, they say statistics don't lie, but liars use statistics. Well, here's just another example where people, you know, sometimes they may even be well-intentioned, but misguided individuals that are trying to use some isolated studies to justify their bad habits.
Yeah. And doesn't it make it harder to lose weight when you're eating a lot of salt?
Oh, I think absolutely. One of the things that salt does is it's a powerful appetite stimulant.
Yes.
And so if you sit down and just eat your fill of stuff till you feel satisfied, you know, you can figure out how much that is. But if you salt up that food a much, you'll find you often do eat more before you reach that natural satiety.
Right.
And, of
right.
course, people like that because it tastes
sure.
better because it stimulates more dopamine. It gets the body, you know,
yeah.
geared up. Salt is an essential nutrient without which you die. In fact, it's so sensitive at detecting salt because of its importance in the natural setting that you can pick up even very small quantities of sodium. That's how you know vegetables are good if you're not perverted on a high-salt diet.
Yeah.
The problem is you're designed to hold salt because in a natural setting there is no concentrated salt.
Right.
And as a consequence, what happens is if you get exposed to large quantities of salt, like we do in virtually all the conventional diets, about a third of the population that's very efficient at holding salt holds the salt. It holds the fluid to protect you against it. Your blood pressure goes up, and then you die prematurely.
Mm.
Now, salt actually used to be a way they killed people. If you take a certain amount of salt, I can't remember what the LD50 is, but it's a relatively small amount, you'll die. If you take a tablespoon, it's an emetic. It makes you throw up.
Right.
In a very small quantity, it's an essential nutrient. But in higher quantity, it's a deadly poison.
Right.
And everything in between. And so, you know, again, fortunately, they're not putting so much salt in the Big Mac now that you drop dead just having one. But it can kill you over the long run because of the consequential increase in blood pressure and swelling and edema and all the other problems that are caused by high-salt diet. So I think, right, you know, eventually the large enough prospective studies will be done that they'll agree that the American Heart Association is, in fact, closer to the truth. I actually think they may still be a little bit generous, but, you know, that's at least debatable.
Wow. Well, thank you. We have several questions on fasting, and maybe you can just talk about them all at once, but let me read all three of them because you can probably put them together in your answer. Okay, so one was, are there any age limits to participating in fasting? One was, why does fasting work for so many different ailments? And the other one was, is do you ever recommend fasting for a healthy person that has no, that's already on this diet, that's at their ideal weight?
Okay, so fasting has actually a number of utilities. Now, realize this is a very ancient practice. There's almost no, or at least no major religious tradition that I've ever come across that doesn't have a tradition of fasting associated with it. Fasting changes the way you think, you feel about yourself and the world around you.
Mm.
It's been used for physical reasons and spiritual reasons and all kinds of different reasons. So yes, healthy people can benefit from periodic fasting, if nothing else diagnostically. Because if you take a person and put them on a fast that thinks they're healthy, sometimes they are, and it's usually uneventful, maybe a little boring. They go through it, and they're done, and it's fine. But many times, people that think they're healthy go on a fast, and they find out they're not quite as healthy as they thought, as the body generates an acute healing crisis and mobilizes accumulated intermediary products of metabolism and toxic products, and the body goes through characteristic predictable unwinding. And so that can be very useful diagnostically as well as therapeutically. Sometimes people, even though they're really working hard at eating well and living right, they still are slipping into some bad habits. And fasting is like rebooting the hard drive in a computer.
Mm.
It clears a lot of corruption and just gives a person a fresh start. Now, granted, a healthy person isn't going to fast for 40 days like Moses, David, Elijah, Jesus, and a couple hundred of our patients. But, you know, they might do a 5-day or 7-day fast in a restful setting and find it, you know, quite useful. I personally find fasting to be an intense and miserable experience.
Wow.
But, you know, I do it because it is useful and it is helpful. It does provide benefit.
Mm-hmm.
So healthy people can fast. Usually it's shorter term and it's for a broad range of reasons. For the person, what was the other question there, AJ?
Is there an age limit? Like, is there, you have to be a certain age, not too old, not too young?
Yeah, fortunately, children normally, if you're diligent about feeding them a healthy diet, are so rapid at healing, it's very unusual that we have to resort to water fasting in children. And you have to be very concerned about that because children have hydration issues different than adults. Just like you're concerned about kids when they have fever because you don't want them to dehydrate, and they dehydrate easier than an adult, fasting in children could become problematic if you try to fast them too long. And you can only fast, although you can fast adults, you know, 30, 40 days or longer, children, it would be a matter of much shorter periods of time that they would be able to fast if you wanted to fast. And you also have to be very concerned because fasting is still not seen as a generally acceptable procedure. And so, you know, if you get child services or other agencies involved, they're going to think that you're Jim Jones or something, you're doing something terrible. So you could really get yourself into some problems there. If fasting is done, whether it's with adults or children, we believe it should be done in conjunction with a medical doctor that's not a complete idiot that can monitor you and provide you good
right.
feedback.
And you have some of the best medical doctors there, Dr. Michael Clapper and Dr. Peter Sultana, have been doing this for 30, 40 years, so I can attest to
Yeah,
that.
We have good medical doctors. It's like, you know, some people collect different things. I like to collect really good doctors. And so we have really good doctors that actually give a damn. And they're kind of unique in that regard. It's very hard to find clinically competent physicians that actually genuinely care for the patients and have the patients to provide a health-promoting care. And so that's a strong suit that we have found a few. They're not an unlimited number of them out there.
Right.
And these guys really do care, and they do a good job of what they do, and they're able to bridge the gap between medicine and alternative medicine because, you know, they've been formally trained. Most of our doctors have worked in conventional settings for much of their life, and now they're hoping to do something worthwhile in the time that they have left, and that's why they tend to come and work with the True North Health Center.
So, can an old person fast, or is there a certain age at which you can no longer fast? That was one of the other questions.
No, actually, older folks tend to fast sometimes even better than younger folks. They're much more patient. They'll do what you tell them to do and
right.
move around a little slower. However, as you start getting into your eighth and ninth decade, we've had some even older than that, like children, you're going to fast shorter periods of time. You don't take a 96-year-old and try to go do a 40-day fast
right.
typically.
Sure.
Okay, because their reserves, their hydration and capacities may be more limited. So fasting duration always has to be appropriate to the patient. And it does help if you're working with people that have done a lot of fasting supervision because we're better able to make those determinations.
Mm.
You know, the fact is we've had now 15,000 people. I found this out recently. For a long time, I've been saying 10,000, but we actually did a breakdown. We've had over 15,000 people undergo fasting.
That's fantastic.
At the True North Health Center over the last 30 years. And we're currently processing somewhere between 700 and 1,000 people a year through the program. So you do learn a bit when you've seen enough people do it. And, you know, we know what to look for. We have our protocols. And those protocols have allowed everybody that's walked in to do fasting to be able to walk out. So we're trying to keep it that way.
Jeanette from Washington wants to know, what do you think of intermittent fast, such as 1 to 2 days a week or 30, mm-hmm. 24 to 36 hours?
Yeah. Unfortunately, as beneficial as intermittent fasting can be as a weight loss strategy, you don't get the really intense detoxification process that are associated with longer-term fasting because it takes the body a few days, actually, to make that acclimation into fasting. So I think there's utility to these intermittent fasts. Victor Longo and others are promoting it, you know, in terms of the inducing genomic changes and other kinds of things and stem cells. And you'll read a lot of stories about,
right.
oh, what they call prolonged fasting up to 4 days and how
wow.
tremendously beneficial it is. Ultimately, there'll be longer-term fasting, and you'll see it's disproportionately beneficial as you get farther into the fast. We know that from what we see
sure.
clinically. Now, they haven't been able to do that up till now because up till now there's not been a safety study that's demonstrated the safety of fasting, and so nobody's been able to get permission from Human Subjects Committee to do that. That's just about to change. We've now completed our fasting safety study on over 2,548 consecutive fasting patients, and we're in the process now of submitting that to one of the major impact journals. We expect, hopefully, you know, this year or early next year that we'll get word that that's been accepted for publication, and then that should open up the door to us and all the other researchers that are looking for human subjects approval on long-term fasting, and then we'll see whether or not doing a very short-term fast really compares to doing what we do
sure.
At True North Health Center, which is longer-term medically supervised water-only fasting.
But just so we
I know clinically you get a little benefit from the short fast, and it may be useful, but what you see on the longer fast is really quite startling.
But just so people don't get scared away on the call, you are allowed to come to True North even if you do not wish to fast, correct? I mean, people...
Right? Oh, yeah. In fact, I can tell you 18% of our patients never skip a meal.
Okay, cool. I was one
okay,
of the...
Okay, so it's about 1 in 5 don't do any fasting. And that number is actually increasing because we have a lot of people. I mean, some people come to the True North Health Center just because they're in town doing business and we're cheaper than the hotels.
Yeah, I
so they can save some money and get their meals. Some people come in because they want a little vacation. And if they go to a vacation someplace else, they get fat and sick and come home exhausted and sick. Where they come here, they can eat healthy food, they can hike, they can do activities, they can be around pleasant people, they can get some education. And so they come to feed. Some people come in and they want to fast, but they're not really able to fast because they still have challenges in terms of their drug withdrawals. We have to wean them off medications or deal with their health issues. Some people have conditions that don't lend themselves well to fasting, at least initially. And so many of our people, like I said, don't even skip a meal. They enjoy the food. We have a fabulous chef.
Absolutely.
And oftentimes we have fabulous guest chef too, like we will over December when you're joining us.
Thank you.
And so the food can be a really good thing.
I can attest to it being a great vacation. And that actually, there is actually a question from Jeanette. She said that I sent out the flyer to my mailing list about the holiday extravaganza. She said she went to the website, but she could not find out how to sign up. How does one sign up? Is there a deadline?
Okay, it's the deadline is only when we have a few beds left. So when people sign up, you know, when the beds are filled, that's it. We didn't put anything on the website because we only promote it to our patients and you to your, you know, you're the exception. You're
I
promoting
see.
It to your clients.
Sure.
But I kind of consider your clients our clients anyway. So
great.
But the point is, it's all in-house. We're not marketing it or anything. We know it's going to fill up. It always fills up. And, you know, so it's kind of a...
So if they want to sign up, they should just call you.
They just sign up like they normally sign up. They just fill out the registration forms and give us a call.
Perfect.
And we answer all their questions and we lock them up. The only thing that's different is that from December 21st to January 2nd, our rates are the same. Everything's the same. But medical exams are optional. So all the rest of the year, everybody that comes in has at least an initial examination with our physician, one of our physicians. During the holiday extravaganza, assuming a person is clinically stable, they're not on medications that we have to deal with or anything, they could have the option of having an exam or not having an exam because we're not doing fasting supervision over that holiday extravaganza. It's more about healthy eating. And then the other difference is we have a number of special guests, including Chef AJ, that, you know, enhance the educational program. We go from 2 live programs a day to 3 live programs a day, sometimes more. And it's a little bit more festive. There's a little bit more flexibility in terms of how we do our food. It's always vegan SOS free, but, you know, we have a little more creativity that gets introduced, a little bit more variety in the diet to take into account the holiday festive, you know, issues. And so it's a little bit more fun.
Yeah.
Because fasting isn't always fun.
Right.
And, you know, and it's so it fills up when it fills up. Right now, I think we've got, 8 or 9 or 10 more beds left. So it won't be long before it's full.
Thank you.
So if you're interested, you can fill out the registration forms on our website and just give a call and we'll lock up whatever, you know, whatever space you want.
Well, I'm really looking forward to it. Judy wants to know that if we are limiting, are there any other foods other than high fat foods like nuts, seeds, and avocado we should be limiting? And if we are not eating those or limiting them due to trying to lose weight or food addiction, should we be taking DHA, EPA?
Okay, well, the only reason you need to take DHA is if you're low in DHA.
Right.
Okay. And the way you do that is you either test for it, or if you have symptoms, you can do a trial of DHA and see if it corrects the challenge.
Okay.
And there are some people that even though they're eating well, and maybe they're even including flax seeds or walnuts or chia seeds or hemp seeds or walnuts or whatever it is, for whatever reason, don't do a good job converting omega-3 fatty acids into docosahexaexonic acid. In the past, people thought, well, that meant you had to take fish oils to get preformed DHA. But you don't anymore. There is a supplemental form of DHA from algae, which is the same place the fish get it. And, you know, so if we have to supplement it, then you can do that. And if people eat no concentrated fats, let's say, for example, you had a food trigger where, you know, even though nuts in small quantities up to an ounce a day might be very healthy, if you eat a little bit, you're going to eat a lot. That happens to people. There are some foods.
Yeah.
You might be an example that you just don't do a good job regulating quantity on a specific kind of food. Well, you can't have that food.
Right.
And if that consequence of that means that you don't get enough essential fatty acids over the long run, then, you know, it might be a situation where somebody would have to supplement. Having said that, though, there's so much omega-3 in green vegetables that most people do fine unless they have some genetic enzyme conversion problem.
I see.
And, you know, because we see a lot of vegan patients, we see the few people that have those conversion problems, and if they're not getting it from the diet, then they develop symptoms and we have to supplement it. Okay.
Well, great.
So, but
Thank
there
you.
is a test. You can do a finger stick, a home kit from Metametrics and check out your DHA levels.
Perfect.
And if they're low, you know, you can either use more flax or greens, and if not, you can supplement it.
Thank you. Melanie wants to know if True North specifically addresses compulsive eating and would only 4 days there help me lose weight?
Well, you can't help but lose weight if you eat less calories because you're going on a better diet.
Right.
Okay, the problem isn't are you going to lose weight. All kinds of, you can go on the dead Dr. Atkins diet and lose weight for a while.
Sure.
That's not the point. The point is, can we help you develop the skills so that you can make behavioral changes so that over the long run you can get healthy and make us look good? And the way that we do that, sometimes it only takes people a short experience, and they might spend a week with us and get a profound impact. But frankly, for most people, they need a longer stay. And the reason is, first, they need to be able to get where they can choke down what initially tastes like tasteless swill, which is oil, salt, and sugar-free food. At first, it's disgusting. They can't eat it. They never stick to that diet at home. But if they come in and eat long enough, or they fast and eat, then they find the good food tastes not bad. And so we have to, if a person comes in and says, no, I already like fruits and vegetables. I just, I'm a, you know, I like my chocolate or I like my whatever. That's different than the person says, vegetables, ugh, disgusting. I don't ever eat vegetables.
Right.
The person that's disgusting and doesn't ever eat vegetables might need to be with us and do a fast and be with us for weeks. For the person that likes good food, but they're just a food addict and they want to go overeat on their other food, sometimes a short stay is all they need. Other times they need to be a little longer to break the cycle. And one way we try that is we do a short stay, and if they comply and do well, then we say we knew it all along. And if not, we bring them back and lock them up for a longer period of time.
Sure.
And frankly, most people have a sense of that themselves, about how stuck into the pleasure trap they are.
Right.
And one way I can tell is if I say to the person, well, we want everybody to prep properly the few days before they come in so they're not so miserable.
Mm-hmm.
And what that means, they're eating fruit, salads, and steamed vegetables only as much as they want, but for 2 or 3 days. Now, some of our people do that, and it's no problem. They think, oh, what's the problem? I just eat all the fruit and salad and steamed vegetables and yams and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Other people, it's like, oh, really difficult.
Right.
They can't really do that easily. And so we do that for them when they come in.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously, if they can't do it even for a couple of days, we know, okay, we're a little bit deeper in the pleasure trap. We're going to need a little more time.
Mm-hmm.
Some people come in, they're already eating that way, but they have a health problem. And so we have to fast them because they're already doing the diet. They're already sleeping. They're already. We have no choice. If we want to get a facilitated response now, that's where fasting can be very helpful. Some people come in, they just do the diet. They get well. We never. In fact, I had a patient the other day. This was funny. She had, I mean, we're talking 2-year workup for peripheral neuropathy, you know, numbness in the
sure.
extremities. And she'd been to podiatrist, orthopedic surgeon, she had an MRI, like $200,000 worth of workup. And they all told her the same thing. They weren't sure why she was having them. They couldn't find disc problems. She didn't have a tumor. They weren't sure. The only thing they also all agreed on it was nothing to do with her diet because she'd asked about that. And, you know, they all told her it wasn't diet, but they didn't know what it was. So in preparation for her to come in, we asked her to follow a program for a week. By the end of the week, she called me up, canceled her stay.
Wow.
And she said she was canceling her stay because she was better.
That's fantastic.
And was pissed because she said, you know, she spent $200,000 and all it took was getting gluten out of her diet in her case.
Wow. Well,
and she said, why didn't anybody ever tell her?
Right. Well, speaking of gluten, that's a question from Mike from Orlando. He said he saw a YouTube clip on you, and he said it sounded like that you recommend a gluten-free diet for everyone, not just people
no.
with celiacs.
I don't say that everybody has to eat a gluten-free diet. First of all, there's a percentage of the population, that percentage is debatable right now, but that cannot handle gluten, and particularly not from modern wheat, which has been hybridized and turned into a different product than traditional wheat. That protein, that gluten in those people, their immune system reacts to it and they destroy their colon. We call it celiac disease.
Mm-hmm.
It's about 1% of the population.
Okay.
But there's also a percentage of the population that their immune system doesn't react to gluten by destroying their stomach lining or their intestinal lining. But instead it reacts to destroying their thyroid gland.
Mm.
And interestingly enough, these people have this HLA-DQ gene. Is the same gene associated with gluten sensitivity that's associated with Hashimoto's thyroiditis.
Interesting.
So the theory is, and this is still, you know, being debated, but the way that the theory goes, people eat gluten that happen to be sensitive to it, it may even be genetic or developmental, And then the immune system reacts and destroys, in this case, the thyroid gland. We call it Hashimoto's thyroiditis. If it destroys the colon or the intestinal tract, we call it celiac disease. It also apparently works with people that have eczema and asthma and psoriasis and other problems, because sometimes just getting the gluten out is enough to have a profound effect on people with asthma and eczema and psoriasis and some of these other inflammatory conditions, okay?
Wow.
So, again, there's still more to be learned about exactly what percentage of the population, all that. But I don't think anybody's going to suggest everybody's gluten sensitive.
Sure.
But for those that are, it needs to be excluded.
But
for those that are not, some people can have it once in a while and not get obvious untoward symptoms. But if they have it every day, they'll definitely notice it.
Sure.
And so we talk about rotational feeding in people with sensitivities. Now, here's the thing. Where is gluten used? Nobody's buying bowls of wheat berries and boiling
right.
them and eating them.
They
They're grinding
bread.
Them into flour,
yes.
increasing caloric density threefold, baking it into bread, often with sugar, oil, and salt,
sure.
and turning it into bread with 1,500 calories a pound.
Yep.
And then they're getting fat, sick, and miserable on it. So why the heck would we want to be getting people eating these highly processed food products with the crackers and the cookies and the breads when
sure.
the people are trying to lose weight and get healthy? So we don't include gluten in any of our recipes
right.
in terms of, you know, what we don't serve it at the center. We don't use glutinous grains. But that doesn't mean that, you know, nobody in the world could eat some wheat products and get away with it.
Sure.
It's just I don't recommend it. But that's different than saying everybody has to be gluten-free.
Got it. But you do recommend wheat-free for everyone? Or
well, what I'm saying is we don't serve wheat.
Right.
We don't put it in our recipes. I'm not saying everybody has to be on a wheat-free diet to be healthy.
Right.
But I don't see where wheat products really fit in
yeah.
to a health-promoting diet right now because of the way it's typically served. But if you wanted to occasionally try to boil some wheat berries and eat them, well, God bless you.
Yeah, or some barley. Great. Thank you so much. Okay, so Victoria wants to know what a no-oil diet's long-term effect on cholesterol is and, more important, hormone balance.
That's a good question. And, of course, it's going to vary radically with the individual. There is no cholesterol in oil. So
right.
eating oil, it's not that you're getting cholesterol from the oils. You're getting fat. Now, the effect of a higher fat diet may have a profound effect on the endogenous production of cholesterol. Remember, most cholesterol, about 80% or more, is made by your body.
Mm.
And so some people, even on a vegan diet, can have hypercholesterolemia because they're making too much cholesterol or they're not binding it with adequate fiber in their gut and eliminating it. So there's a lot of things you can do to lower cholesterol, like eating plant-rich vegetable fiber foods. Now, eating too much fat in the form of oils might affect your triglycerides, as would eating too much sugar, including too much fruit or dried fruits or fruit juices.
Mm-hmm.
And so if your triglycerides are elevated, that's somebody, let's say we have a patient that has hypertriglyceridemia, but is not eating animal foods or, dairy products and all that stuff. Well, we'll look how much oils are they taking. If they're not eating oils, then we'll say, okay, well, how much sugar are they taking? Simple sugars. And those are patients that we sometimes have to restrict the amount of simple sugars in order to get their body to normalize its triglyceride levels, which, by the way, they almost always do.
Are there certain foods that help lower triglycerides?
Yeah, a health-promoting vegan SOS-free diet. In other words, it's the vegetable materials that are not excessively high in fat that help the body normalize. So I think you want to get away from thinking, which food are you doing to counteract the effect of a bad diet? The best food to eat to counteract the bad diet is a healthy food. So,
right.
again, fruit, salad, steamed vegetables, potatoes, rice, beans, nuts, and seeds in quantity, not meat, fish, fowl, eggs, dairy products, oil, salt, and sugar.
Yeah, I only asked that because we did have a question if there were certain foods for lowering cholesterol or triglycerides, but your answer is just eat the foods you mentioned, the health
Well, particularly the vegetable-based foods because of the nature of their fiber, their binding effect, you know, the low in fat, et cetera, that would be. So as much vegetables as you can shove in.
Right. So the same thing. We
Both
have a question
raw and cooked.
Preventing and reversing osteoporosis. It would be the same thing. Eat the health-promoting
well,
diet.
Well, it's not quite the same thing, though, because with osteoporosis, there's a number of variables. Yes, you want a mineral-rich health-promoting diet. You want a diet that's low in protein. In other words, you don't want sulfur amino acids, so you don't want those animal acids. You don't want bone-leaching chemicals like you'd get from coffee or soda pop in the diet.
Mm-hmm.
And you do want a diet that's, you know, maybe 10-12% of calories from protein, which is what our diets are, 15-18% of calories from fat, and the balance from complex carbohydrates. And then you want to do weight-bearing exercise. We know even healthy astronauts sent to space, if they don't get resistance training, become osteoporotic. What you don't use, you lose.
Interesting.
So if you want to, and weight-bearing exercise are things like walking, where you put load on your bones, and weight training, okay? Not so much swimming and things like that. Not that swimming isn't good, but you wouldn't get
right.
the same training effect. So, and also hormonal balance. And the way to balance hormones is not doing the things that unbalance hormones, which is eating the animal foods and the oils and the sugars and all the other stuff that we do.
Right.
And then, of course, we also use sometimes fasting to kind of reboot that system. Whether people are having menopausal symptoms or perimenopausal symptoms, or they're having problems with dysmenorrhea, which is painful menstruation, or they're having fibrocystic breast disease because they're not converting estradiol to estriol for excretion, or they're growing uterine fibroid tumors.
Mm.
You know, the diet over time may work, but fasting can make it work a lot quicker. And so sometimes we'll start off by doing some fasting and then followed by a vegan SOS-free diet.
Sure. Terrific. What are your thoughts on flu shots, erythritol, and nutritional yeast?
Well, flu shots, I have a big concern, because although in childhood immunizations due to pressure from parents, they've removed thimerosal, which is the mercury-based preservative, it's still present in flu shots. And so they're a huge source of mercury contamination and all
wow.
that. And that's because it's a little bit cheaper, so they can use multi-injector vials instead of having to do individual injectors.
Oh.
And so it makes the drug companies a little more money.
Mm.
And so, but I would be concerned also, then there's the issue, does it work? And even if it does work, what's the price you pay in terms of, one of the big arguments about autoimmune disease is that you introduce these proteins under the skin in an unnatural way. Not everybody does well with it. I just got a call this week from a young man, 25 years old, who within a couple of days of his vaccination, his booster vaccinations, has developed overwhelming, debilitating disease. You know,
wow.
It appears to be associated with his exposure. And, you know, it happens, and people write it off, and, you know, if it's not you, you don't care, but,
sure.
you know, there is risk associated with these procedures, and the risk-reward benefit is extremely questionable. But there's books out there that you can read and talk about, you know, what the benefits of these procedures are in terms of herd immunity and society as a whole versus what the risk to you as an individual is.
Sure.
But anyway, as far as flu is concerned, I'd much rather take my chances with influenza than I would with the immunization personally. And,
right.
of course, the best immunization is being healthy.
Right.
And so, you know, that's what we want. And using good hygiene habits like washing your hands and trying to minimize unnecessary exposure. So, you know, there's a lot you can do by not being sleep deprived, by not eating crappy diet, by engaging in appropriate but not excessive activities, by generously getting sleep, and not having too much stress. You know, they say stress is like Christmas.
Right.
It's better to give than receive, and so we want our patients to be very generous.
Oh, you're terrific. Erythritol and nutritional yeast.
Well, nutritional yeast is a food byproduct, so like all food byproducts, I don't like them. However, nutritional yeast is a relatively benign product. Some people don't do well with it because it tends to lead to a lot of gas and dysbiosis in their gut, and that's not everybody. Some people can eat it. And do fine. It is a very concentrated protein food, so you want to be careful how much you'd use because, again, we're more concerned about too much rather than too little protein. And, it, you know, if somebody liked the flavor, which, you know, I don't personally, but if they liked the flavor and it enhanced their life a little bit and they used it in small enough quantities, like all highly processed food byproducts, they'd probably get away with it.
Okay.
And as far as what was the other thing?
Erythritol. I'm not
what
even
the
sure.
Hell
it's
is
some
that?
Kind of erythritol.
Which one? Is that one of the phony sugars, or what are we talking about?
It's phony. I believe it's made from corn. And it supposedly
is
has...
Is that one of the non-caloric sugars?
Well, I don't think supposedly... I heard that it has no effect on blood sugar, and it's... I don't really know much about it, to tell you the truth, because I don't even...
No, I think I looked this... I think I looked this up. I think this is one of the... If I'm wrong, the answer can still be relevant. There's a bunch of these kind of non-nutritional sugars. They taste sweet, but they don't have any calories.
And they, yeah,
so they're used, they're thinking, everybody's thinking it's going to be, now you can keep eating, you know, sweetie foods, but not get fat on it.
Yeah.
And the problem with most of these kinds of non-nutritive sweeteners is that when you actually look at the studies from a weight management standpoint, they're a disaster. They actually result in weight gain, not weight loss. Not because there's calories in them, but because of what they do to the brain. and they muck up with the satiety situation, and people end up eating more total calories, not less. And there's virtually no studies that, like, drinking diet sodas and all these things is of help. I don't remember. I'd have to look it up, AJ, if this is one of those or not. You know,
Sure.
I have so little interest in all these chemical food
Sure.
byproduct things that
I
I
understand.
really defer to Dr. Clapper and other people on our staff to keep up on all that nonsense, because frankly, I really don't care.
Right. Because we should be eating whole foods anyway.
We just got to eat whole foods. That's what it always comes
Right.
back down to. I
And
spent 30 years chasing down all this nonsense, and it's
I
just, you got to do the diet, the sleep, the exercise. If it's not working fast enough, you speed it up with a fast, and that's pretty much the things you can do that work. I want you to think about something, AJ. If you are having a condition, let's say you have high blood pressure, or you have diabetes, or you have ankylosing spondylitis, or rheumatoid arthritis, or asthma, eczema, or psoriasis, or any of these conditions, and you go to a medical doctor, and you say, "Doctor, what should I do?" And he'll say, "Well, I'll tell you exactly what to do. Here's the drugs you have to take. You have to take them exactly the way I tell you. If you do exactly what I say, I promise you, you'll never get well. You'll be sick the rest of your life, and you'll die either from your disease or my treatment of your disease. I promise you. That's the guarantee." That's why they say, "How long do you take the drugs when you have high blood pressure? For a
Forever.
week?"
Yeah,
"No,
nope.
forever. For the rest of your life." Same thing with diabetes, same thing with autoimmune. How do they know you need to take these drugs with all their toxic potential side effects for the rest of your life?
Because they
Because
don't
they're
want it.
guaranteeing you'll never get well.
Well, we have many, we're not going to get to a lot of the questions. We'll have time for just one more because I really want to know the answer to this. It's an individual resistant cholesterol following a whole food plant-based diet, but still drinking coffee.
Okay, well, the good news is coffee increases endogenous production of cholesterol. So just getting the coffee may help break that cycle. However, if it doesn't, therapeutic water-only fasting can be very helpful in helping bring down persistent hypercholesterolemia. Also, remember, stress and other variables may be a factor in excess cholesterol production. So, you
Interesting.
know, it's not just diet that interplays. I'd also like to suggest for your callers that if their question didn't get answered, or if they have a question, I would be more than happy to answer their questions, and all they'd have to do is call me
Cool.
at the Chinook Health Center. There's no cost involved. All they have to do is call me at 707-586-5555. My personal extension is 2022. Goes right to my desk. It would be helpful if they filled out what we call the registration forms on our website, which gets me their full medical history, and they can do that on the website. What that does is it gets a couple hundred questions answered that help me efficiently kind of get them answers that are meaningful. And so I would review that, provide a free consultation, and also answer any questions that they might have. If they would prefer, they can email me, and my personal email address is dracg at comcast.net. They can email me any question, and I try to stay up on the email and answer them promptly. And also, if they go to our website at healthpromoting.com, we have a pretty exhaustive website with True North TV and videos. We just posted a new video that Dr. McDougall did with me on fasting, and there's an article in GQ magazine that came out recently that's really quite funny. It's called, you know, "How a Terrible 6-Day Fast Changed My Life." And
Wow.
it's a cute article by the author of GQ magazine, who said, you know, he comes in, he says, "Who are these people? These people are crazy." And he says, "Oh, I'm well." And he overcomes inflammatory arthritis, gets off his drugs, loses 20 pounds, and I understand he's become a vegan. So,
Wow.
you know.
That's fantastic. Dr. Goldhammer, you are so entertaining and so knowledgeable. I can't thank you enough for being on the call. Hopefully, you'll do it again in a few months because we didn't get to all these questions. And for those of you listening, thank you. And remember, if you want to lose weight, all you have to do is remember these five words. Do everything Dr. Goldhammer said. Also, if you just want to get well. Thank you so much, Dr. Goldhammer, and good night, everyone.
Good night.